Ladies and gentlemen, so let's begin on a very, very enthusiastic note. We have with us none other than Mr. Sanjay Puri from the Sanjay Puri Architects to make his presentation and share his perspectives with us. So let's have a huge round of applause. Please help me welcome on stage our first speaker, Mr. Sanjay Puri.
Good morning. So we'll briefly run you through three projects, each of which have imbibed tradition in a different way. The first one is a very small building, an office building in Jaipur. That's a site. It's on one of the main arterial roads in Jaipur. And when one moves through Jaipur, Jaipur is one of the most architecturally rich cities in India. The chances are that within 15 minutes of from where you've left, you will cross one of these buildings on the way, in any direction. And unfortunately, the last decade or so has seen these kind of buildings being built in Rajasthan, in Jaipur and Udaipur and every other city. Complete curtain walled buildings in temperatures which are in excess of 40 degrees Celsius through 8 months of the year. So this is our site, really small. It's only 1,000 square meters. And once you leave the required setbacks that are required, as well as calculate the amount of FAR that is available on this plot, what you get is this kind of box in terms of scale. And the height doesn't allow you to go higher than this. The open spaces don't allow you to go bigger than this. In fact, the funny thing is that the maths doesn't work. The FAR is 3 here, and with these restrictions, because the site was small, you actually can't consume the complete FSI. So you looked around in Rajasthan. Of course, there are domes, there are arches, there are lots of elements. We want to use one element which would be suited for that kind of office building because the scale is very different. A palace scale is completely different. An office building which has got only 11 feet height, floor heights, is very different. So we took just the jali screen, and this is what we've used in the building. So the jali wraps around the entire building, and it creates an envelope around the building. It reduces the heat gain by 30%, and thereby makes the building energy efficient. It allows the windows to be opened in the good weather, which starts now next month for 4 months. The plan is relatively very simple. The service core is on the southern side so that you again reduce the heat gain into the building, and the columns on the periphery so that there's complete flexibility on every floor based on the client's requirements, where they want to put cabins, where they want to put open workstations. So it's a small 6-level building. And what we've done is use the jali screen in a fractured manner with angled panels twisting throughout the entire building. So it is a traditional element, but it's used in a contemporary abstract way. These are the details of how it was fixed. Very simple, steel pipes, 4-inch diameter, take the entire load off the GRC jali panels, which wrap the building all around. Those are on-site construction photographs. And this is the envelope that's created around the building. So you can see that the windows are openable, and there's this whole planter bed that is all around the building. And in the next slide, you will see how it's a very, very busy road, and that kind of a thing makes a lot of difference also in terms of cutting the noise from the main road. This is the traffic on this road all throughout the day. So that's the building, very simple building with this jali pattern all through, which creates an energy efficient solution contextual to its location. The fractured element is continued throughout the interior as well. And you can see how there is actually no artificial light required to be put on up till 6:30 in the evening when sun sets. And you get all these interesting patterns all throughout the office. In the building at night, like a lantern. This next project is also in Rajasthan. It's part of a large 100-acre site where we're doing a township. Now, these were the allocations of areas given to us by the clients, that there's a main road towards where the public areas are written, and that's the only access. And this whole site is actually virtually in the middle of nowhere, in the sense that it is close to Biawar, which is a very, very small city in itself. So this is located at Ras, and the Ras actual village is 2 kilometers from this. So there is nothing around this site. So it has to be completely self-sufficient. So all the public areas were required to be planned next to the road for obvious reasons. And then the residential portion was deeper inside. So these are the contours on the site. The first part where the public areas are relatively very flat. And after that, there is a contour difference about 8 to 10 meters going up and down. And this is the allocation in detail of the spaces that were finally decided to be done. Now, when we looked at this, we said that this commercial building that is planned here should actually be moved around this water collection body. Now, in Rajasthan, which is a desert, it's anyway very rare to have water, and this site has natural water collection throughout the year. And that natural collection is about 18 meters deep, so it's an actual contour difference where water collects through the air. So we told the clients we'd rather shift the commercial building around the water and thereby free that space in between, so that becomes a playground as well as a buffer between the school and the office building. The clients argued for about 2 months for this. They said, you got all this flat land and you want to go and build in the most complicated part, which has an 18 meter contour difference. But finally they were convinced. These are the photographs of the site as it is with the water right now. So the first thought that came to mind while looking at this steeply contoured site was to create something derived from the step wells of India, which have been prevalent in that region for a long time. And based on the requirements of the office building, which is 90,000 square feet, they divided into two blocks of 45,000 square feet, and then each of these step up on the contours facing the north side. So the south, which has the maximum heat gain, is completely sheltered by the earth itself. So there is zero heat gain from the south. All office spaces face the north. And at the same time, they all get terraces that they can spill out to. So that's the eventual form where each floor staggers and goes back on the existing contours. So you're doing no cutting filling. And at the same time, we increase the water reservoir area so that this water can now supplement the water supply for the entire township. So in cross section, four levels go down, one level at the ground and then one level elevated, from which there is a sloping slab which has a landscape garden on top. The reason to do this is to create a covered parking space, because unlike most buildings, including this one, you'd come here, you go down to a basement to car park, or you go to an office building, you have podiums, even residential buildings. In this case, because you're building down, you had to create surface parking spaces, and surface parking spaces don't work in Rajasthan. You can't leave your car outside for 15 minutes also. So there's a whole sheltered berm all around, and the opposite two sides are exactly derived from the step wells, which are in Gujarat and Rajasthan both. So that was the formation of the entire idea, the way it took germ and the way those steps became office spaces with terraces at different parts. That's the earthworm, the two circulation entry and exit points. And solar panels on the southern side, which are the steeper slopes under which the cars are placed. We have solar energy throughout the year. And then the building as it steps down. The width is not more than 8 meters anywhere, which is because natural light can penetrate up to 7.5 to 8 meters. And the entire building will be built in Chittorgarh stone, which is available within a 2 kilometer radius from the site. Those are the details of the stepwell, where we actually created planter spaces as well as little sheltered niches where you can sit inside. So that's in addition to the original stepwells, the way they used to be. So when you're driving around this building, you don't see it at all. That's the southern side with the solar panels on top of the earth berm. And then when you come down to the ground level, which is below, 18 meters below, that's where you see this water and all the offices facing it. and are in the office building, looking out towards the stepwell sides. So the reservoir is not just an office building, it becomes a community space for the entire township that it's planned in. That's the size of the office spaces, each looking out into these terraces. So it's a very sustainable design solution for a location based on its context as well as imbibing tradition. This is the third and last project today, which is an ISKCON temple in Ahmedabad city. Now, temples, of course, are there in many, many, many thousands all through the country. There are various sizes, various scales, and various kinds of decoration on them. The basic spaces have always been the same, the Ardha Mandap where you enter, the Mandap, the main hall, and the Garbhgriha where the deity is kept. So you look at temples in the 1000 AD, 1100, 1200, 1300, and even what is being built now. The sectional spaces are generally always the same. It's the decor that changes, the scale that changes, the size that changes. Now this is the site for the temple. It's towards the outskirts of Ahmedabad, very close to Ahmedabad city. To Science City in Ahmedabad. And this temple is not one of those temples that we generally see around. This is for ISKCON. ISKCON has, most of you who probably have been to one, about 80,000 people on a weekend. And when we got the requirements, we were like, how is this a temple? It's 160,000 square feet of space is what they wanted to build, including meditation halls and a prasadam room where they give free food all through the day. Just the shoe collection area is about 8,000 square feet, because that's the number that comes. A lot of people in very little time. So how does one make a temple look like a temple the way a temple is perceived when you have 160,000 square feet of built-up area to be consumed? So this 160,000 square feet area is planned in two basements, which we'll come to later on. And then looking back at temples, you see that what is that one distinct element that never changes is the shikhar. The shikhar's decoration changes. So what he did is we took a two-dimensional plane of the shikhar and multiplied this 180 times, stacked it together to make a huge, large shikhar, which finally covers the temple space. And then the interstitial spaces between these planes are filled with jali panels, which are derived from the jalis that have been in traditional architecture. So that's a cross-section where hot air is allowed to rise, and that's the whole layout plan. So in the complete layout, they have an ashram and they have a kitchen where they serve, I think, 50,000 meals a day to schools. But the main temple portion is this what has been entrusted to us to plan. So when you come in, you see this large water body and you walk around it, and then you come into the main temple space. And all the ancillary functions which they needed are all planned in two basements below. So that's one of the basements. There's a large car parking space as well underneath. And all these spaces are lit with courtyards which are on the periphery of the temple. So that's a cross section. It goes 48 meters high. And that's the detail of the construction and the detail of the light well, which brings natural light into the two levels below. That's the detail of the corridor that runs around the water and then finally takes you to the temple space. And this is the first image when you walk into the temple. So you have this whole water body, which is again derived from the stepwells. And then you walk through these jali screens on both sides. And the whole top area is landscape, so that this allows for those large congregation times when there's Diwali and there are all these big puja areas. These are the light wells which give light to the two basement levels below. And that's the main temple space. So it echoes the temple the way it used to be, but yet it's completely different in its rendition of form. And one very important thing is that all Indian temples, although the shikhar is the highest portion, you can never perceive that highest portion from the inside. It's always shut, and it's always only symbolic to show a temple from a distance. In this case, you actually see the entire space because you move through that whole volume. So see, these are some of the elements, once again, to recapsulate: indirect light, reduced heat gain, the water evaporation that create this temple in a sustainable manner. There was supposed to be music playing with this, but the music was not found. So just running you through the spaces once again in sequence. That brings me to the end. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, sir. If I may kindly request you to please remain on the stage. I'd like to once again invite Mr. Sanjay Puri to please remain on the stage. Yes, sir.
Yeah, good morning. Yeah, Mr. Puri, most of your designs which I saw had a lot of jalis and, you know, a lot of curves and... So how about cleaning the thing, like cleaning, there will be a lot of dust collections and all.
Jalis have been prevalent since a long time as part of traditional architecture. And with the wind, it doesn't clean on its own. It's there since how many centuries all over India.
Thank you.
All right. So then on that note, I'd like to invite Mr. Mario to please come on stage. We have with us Mr. Mario from Lingil, India, to please come forward and present a token of gratitude to Mr. Sanjay Puri. Let's have a round of cheer. Come on, ladies and gentlemen. It's a bright Saturday morning. Thank you very much.